All right. Hello, everybody. Thanks for being patient with us while we figured out the room situation. My name is James McNellis. I'm a software developer on the Visual C++ team at Microsoft, and I'm going to talk a bit about Unicode today, specifically Unicode in C++. Though the first part is going to be basically an introduction to text encoding in Unicode. So we're going to go through terminology and explain basically how text encoding works and why Unicode is important. And then we'll look at, toward the second half, we'll look at the problems with that we have with Unicode and or why it is difficult to work with Unicode text, and look at a little bit of how we can do that effectively in C++. So just one caveat before we start. Anytime I say byte, we're talking about an 8-bit byte here. So if there are people who work in embedded systems, we're not, you know, we're assuming an 8-bit byte for this presentation to keep things simple. So before we start talking about Unicode, clearly Unicode is not that old, and we have been encoding text on computers for quite some time. And so what did we do before there was Unicode? And first we can start looking at what we'll call single byte encodings. And one of these that everybody is quite familiar with is ASCII. I think everybody here should be familiar with ASCII. We can encode all of these nice letters and other characters. It's a 7-bit encoding, so it only requires 7 bits to encode each character. It has 32 control characters and 95 printable characters, and those are shown on the screen. And this is great for English. It's also great for C++. You can write any C++ you want with all this, but it's not so great for most other languages. And the way that these single byte encodings work, it's quite straightforward. If we have some text, so for example, we have this string hello, we take each character and we map it to what we call a code point. And the code point is a numeric value, and it's a unique value that maps to that character. So in this case, we take the H and we map it to 48, and we take the E and we map it to 65. And so we have this nice string of numbers, basically, that represent this string. One other comment for this presentation, anytime there are numbers on the slide, they're hexadecimal numbers, just to keep things simple. I've omitted the 0x to keep the slides terser. So ASCII is near ubiquitous. It's used in many environments. Unicode is based on it. And like we said, it's great for English, but not so great for other languages, because other languages have many characters beyond what was in that list of 95 printable characters. So one nice thing about ASCII is that it's only a 7-bit encoding. So if we have an 8-bit byte, we've got a whole extra 128 values that we can use, code points that are unused by ASCII. And so we can use those to represent other characters. And so we have what are called extended ASCII encodings. And these are just a handful of them that are very common. So IBM came up with a set of code pages. macOS Roman is a commonly used code page on macOS. And there are others. And basically the way these work is the lower 128 code points, they map to the same values as they do in ASCII. And then the upper 128 we map to other characters. So for example, code page 437 is the default code page on DOS. If you have a Windows system and you open up a console window, it starts off in this code page by default. And you can see here, we can represent a whole bunch of accented characters, which are useful for European languages. We can represent a whole bunch of boxes, which if you're on DOS are really great for drawing out crude text UI. We've got some mathematical symbols for maybe some text spreadsheet software. There are a set of these basically extended ASCII character sets that are standardized under ISO IEC 8859. So this is a set of encodings. There are a bunch of them listed here. The most common that people here in the United States might be familiar with are the Latin 1 Western European. And so we can see here that these are the extra characters that you get that you can represent using Latin 1. And this is sufficient to cover 29 languages completely, including German, Danish, Italian, Spanish, and others. The Latin 9 encoding technically supersedes this, but it's less common, and it is usable to represent a few other languages like French, Finnish, and Estonian. So there are other encodings here, though. So for example, Latin Cyrillic is another encoding, and these are the extra characters that you get, the Cyrillic alphabet. And this is usable for Russian, Bulgarian, Belarusian, Serbian, and other languages. And encoding for these works just the same way that encoding works for ASCII. We have a string of text here, and we take each character and we map it to the corresponding code point in the encoding. So here, the A is not actually the Latin letter A. It's the Cyrillic letter. And so we map it to B0, and then we map the other letters accordingly. This is the Russian word for hello, I believe. If it's not, then Google Translate. I'll need to talk to them. And decoding works in the same way. So if you have a string of, or if you have an array of code points, you can take each of them and map them to the corresponding letter. But there's a bit of a problem with this, because there's not just this one encoding. And so if you, you know, if you have this array of bytes, it doesn't tell you, hey, this is in, you know, this happens to be in 8859-5. And if we tried, for example, to decode it in 8859-7, which is Latin Greek, you'll get this gibberish. And so this is a very common problem when we have, you know, multiple text encodings that we have to deal with. So to summarize, you know, these single byte encodings, like, they do. They have many really nice properties. Each character is the same size, so, you know, it's easy to work with the text. The encodings are compact, right? I mean, one byte per character is about as compact as we could get. Yes, ASCII is only 7 bits per character, and so maybe we could compress it a bit more, but then it's really inconvenient to work with. And string operations are generally very straightforward, right? We have a very robust library of operations in the C standard library, like strcpy and strlen, and then we have C++ equivalents in the C++ standard library that, you know, offer better safety and such. But there aren't enough code points to represent all characters, right? We've already seen that even with just European languages, we cannot represent, you know, all of the characters used in all of those languages using only 256 code points. And then when we start including Asian languages, which have many more characters than European languages, then this is a major problem. So one way to solve this is with variable length encodings. And with variable length encodings, basically, if one byte is not enough, how about we use multiple bytes? And so just one note, variable length is sometimes referred to as multi-byte, because you know, we may represent things using multiple bytes. This is one example of such an encoding. Basically, some characters end up being representable using a single byte, and those are based on the ASCII character set. And then two-byte characters consist of a lead byte and a trail byte. The lead byte will always have the high bit set, and then the trail byte may be any value. So as an example of this, we can, you know, if we're parsing text and we're pointing at a code unit and we see a 44, we can say, ah, that is the Latin capital letter D. However, if we're parsing along and we find an 84, we say, okay, that has the high bit set, see the 8 there. So we combine that with the next character, and then we use a lookup table to go and figure out what that combined pair of bytes maps to. And in this case, it's the Cyrillic capital D. Similarly, if we come across an 84 followed by another 84, it's another Cyrillic letter. The problem with this is that if you have a pointer into a buffer, you know, and you don't know, is this the initial character, or is this the initial code unit of a character, is it a lead byte or a trail byte, you have to actually walk all the way backward until you can know for sure, right? Because if you're pointing at an 84, like, you don't know, that could be either the lead byte or the trail byte of this character here. And so you could, like, to find out, like, where is the start of the next character, you may have to walk all the way back to the beginning of the buffer and then scan forward again. So this is a common problem with many primitive variable length encodings. Obviously, there are some advantages here, though. With two bytes, you can represent up to 32,896 characters, theoretically. The real-world encodings tend to have lower limits because you need to account for the ability to encode some characters using only a single code unit. Some byte-oriented string operations still work, so you can still use strcpy to copy these strings. But there's a whole bunch of disadvantages, right? They're complex to parse. This depends on the particular encoding. And to be clear, that was just one example. There are other kinds of encodings. For example, there are encodings that shift between different character sets. So for example, you might start off in ASCII, and then there will be a control character to say, hey, switch to another character set. And then you stay in that character set until you shift out. And that kind of encoding is even more complex because, you know, you don't even know what encoding you're in if you're pointing somewhere random in the string, and you have to parse backwards. So because of that, many simple string operations become very difficult, or they require special APIs to handle. And we still have the same problem that there are many different encoding standards, right? There's many of these. We don't, you know, and if you just get some array of data, you don't know how that data is encoded. So Unicode is the solution to that. And we're going to start off talking about Unicode 1.0. So this was Unicode as it was initially standardized. This is not what Unicode is today. And then we'll look after that at what Unicode is today. So given that 256 characters are not enough, and given that multi-byte encodings are a pain to work with, 8 bits aren't enough, let's use 16. 65,535 characters ought to be enough. The name Unicode was originally derived from unique, universal, and uniform character encoding in 1987. So there's a couple of design goals. Basically, it's intended to be the one character encoding to rule them all. It's universal, so it needs to be able to represent all the characters used in regular text interchange. So this means not just languages from European, or not just characters from European languages, but also from Asian languages, and nowadays even from defunct languages that are no longer used for common discussion, but you know may need to appear in text, in citations, or in academic papers, and such things. We want it to be efficient, right? So plain text should be simple to parse. We don't want those variable length encodings where you know we've got to do linear scans in some cases just to parse the next character. And finally, it has to be unambiguous. So any given Unicode code point must always represent the same character. So if we come across a particular value, like we had in ASCII where we see a 48 and we know that that happens to map to the letter H, then you know we want to always know that if I see a 48, that is always the Latin letter H. Finally, Unicode is a set of characters, not glyphs. So for example, you have many fonts on your computer. Unicode is not concerned about like what the characters actually look like when you render it onto paper. It just cares about like what these, you know, what the abstract form of the character is. So with Unicode 1.0, each character is simply mapped to a 16-bit code point. Up to 65,536 characters are thus represented, at least in theory. There's fewer in practice, and we'll see why. One nice thing is that all of the characters in Latin 1 map to the same code points, and we'll see why that's nice in a moment. And so this first encoding is called UCS2, and I believe that's universal character set, and the 2 means that it takes 2 bytes to represent any given character. And so here we can see with our hello string, basically we map each character to its corresponding code point. And in Unicode, when we want to refer to an abstract code point and not talk about how it's actually encoded in a byte stream, we use U plus followed by the code point number. And so here we can say that H, we can see that the H maps to the 48 and E maps to 65 and so on. And so the nice thing about this is that if you have ASCII text and you want to convert it to Unicode, you can simply do so by expanding each 8-bit value into a 16-bit value and zero filling the holes that you've made. But, you know, if we could just represent hello using Unicode, that's not particularly exciting. We could do that before. And so, you know, we can see here that we can represent characters from all sorts of languages, all in a single stream. Here we have Latin, Greek, Cyrillic, Japanese, Mongolian, the Snow People, and Arabic. Decoding works similarly. So here, for example, we've got this stream of bytes. We take each byte, or we take each pair of bytes, we combine them together to form the code point, and we then transform it into the letters that are represented by those code points. Does anybody see what the problem is with this? Yes, we have a little byte ordering problem. This assumes that we are on a big endian machine. And if we're parsing this and we're on a little endian machine, or a machine that expects little endian 16-bit integers, then we're going to parse this and we're going to get gibberish. This is meaningless text here. So in order to solve this problem, there is what's called a byte order mark, and it is this special special code point, FEFF. It doesn't map to a character. What it means is when you see this in a byte stream, that tells you what the byte order is of the encoded text. So the advantage here is we see FEFF, and we know that FE is the high order byte of that 16-bit code point. And so because the FE appears first, this is a big endian byte string, or has big endian 16-bit code points. Similarly, if we want to have a little endian string, you can see I've swapped the order of all the bytes, then the FF will appear first, and so we can identify how the text is encoded. This is a bit of a pain, but it is fairly efficient, and it allows us to work with this text. So UCS2 has a bunch of advantages. Like, there's a huge number of characters representable, 65,000 characters. That's a ton of characters, right? Characters from different scripts are easily combinable into a single string, and each code point is representable using a single code unit, so the encoding is simple, it's efficient. If you want to get to the 12th character, then you can simply take your pointer, add 12, and you're pointing at the 12th character. But there's disadvantages. There's multiple possible byte ordering, so you need the byte order mark for interchange. Similarly, if you receive text in one byte order and you need it in the opposite byte order, you have to go and actually transform all of the 16-bit elements. Every character requires 2 bytes, So text from many languages now requires twice as much storage. So if you have plain English text, your text files are now twice as large, which is certainly a downside. And finally, none of the byte-oriented string functions. So like strict copy no longer works on these Unicode strings because you may have 0 bytes anywhere in the string. So when Unicode 1.0 was published, this is a clip taken from the standard. You can see we used up about half of the space perhaps, and we had about half of the space left for remaining to allocate for future characters. And indeed, if you read the Unicode 1.0 introduction, it says with over 30,000 unallocated character positions, the Unicode character encoding provides sufficient space for foreseeable future expansion. It might as well say that 65,000 characters ought to be enough for anybody. So here, this graph shows two things. On the x-axis, you can see these are each of the successive versions of the Unicode standard. The blue line shows you how many distinct characters there are in each revision of the standard. And the red line shows you the growth in the number of distinct values representable using 16 bits. You can see that the 16-bit integers are not keeping up. So this is a bit of a problem. And because of this problem, Unicode today is not what Unicode was in Unicode 1.0. So we're going to skip the rest of the history, and we're now going to just look at where we're at today. That first piece is very important to understand systems today, but going forward, we can look solely at, how do things work today? So clearly, a fixed-width 16-bit encoding wasn't good enough. In Unicode 2.0, the code space was expanded to 1.1 million characters. This is 21 bits. Because clearly, if 16 bits isn't enough, the next number of bits the computers are really fast at working with are 21. No, that's not it at all. But we'll see why we have that limit in a bit. So if we want to encode text now, if 16 bits is enough space, the next efficient amount of storage that we can allocate is 32 bits. So UCS2 is dead, and let's take a look at the new encoding, UTF-32. So now I've had to shorten our string to just high because I can't fit all the bytes across the slide, but we can see that we still have the 48, so it's still the same code point value that maps to the letter H, and we've now just encoded it with 4 bytes. Again, with UTF-32, we have the byte ordering problem, so we still have the same byte order mark that we had in UCS2. And it works both for big endian and little endian. Now, there's actually a big problem with this still, and that is, if you see this, you have no way of knowing, is this a UTF-32 string, or is it a UCS-2 or UTF-16 string? Let's see UTF-16 in a bit. Generally UTF-32 does not appear in practice, because as you can see, we're using up 4 times as much space. This is extremely inefficient. But generally, like if you were to see this during text processing, the presence of a byte order mark without any, with then a null terminator, would be generally an indication that this is a UTF-32 encoded string. And the nice thing about UTF-32 is that if we have code points that are larger than those that require more than 16 bits to represent, so for example, if you want a rabbit in your text, you can use U+1F430. So the advantages here are, we can represent a huge number of characters. In theory, we could represent 2 to the 32nd characters, which surely would be enough for anybody, right? And each code point is representable using a single code unit, so the encoding is still simple. But there's tons of disadvantages. There's still 2 different byte orderings, so we have all the problems of UCS2. Every character now requires 4 bytes. And because we said, we're limiting ourselves to 21 bits of that character space, we're literally wasting at least 11 bits per code point, and for ASCII text, we're wasting 24 bits per code point. This is extremely inefficient. This text encoding is convenient when you need to be able to quickly index individual characters. We'll see in a bit that that's not such a useful thing to be able to do. So this does not appear very much in practice. We don't want to have to use UTF-32. The most popular encoding. Basically, we solve the problem by having different encodings. So the most popular Unicode encoding today is UTF-8. And what UTF-8 does is it's a variable width encoding. So some characters are encoded using 1 byte, some with 2, some with 3, and some with 4. What you do is we say, if the code point value is between 0 and 7F, then we'll just represent it as a single byte. If it's between 80 and 7FF, then we'll encode it in 2 bytes. And here you can see what the bytes look like. any of the digits that are filled in, like those are the fixed digits, those tell you what the encoding is, and then the X's are where you would put the actual bits of each character. So one nice thing here is that ASCII text is also valid UTF-8 text. There's no difference in the encodings there, because we said that all of the Latin, because Latin 1 is based on UTF-8, and Unicode, all of the Latin 1 characters map to the same code point. So here, decoding UTF-8 text works just like decoding ASCII. We take each of the code units that we see here, we decode that into a code point, and then we render it as, you know, the character to which it corresponds. But we're not limited to ASCII. You know, as we're parsing along, we can say, okay, here's a 58, so that's clearly the letter X, and then we can find CE94, and then we decode it using the mappings from, or using the encoding pattern from the table before, and we find that maps to code point 394, which is the letter delta, and so on and so forth. And we can see here that, again, we can encode the rabbit, which is outside of what is representable using UTF-16. So one nice thing about UTF-8 is it does not have a lot of the problems that legacy variable width encodings have. You can look at any byte in isolation and know whether it is a lead or trail byte. So all trail bytes have the top two bits 1-0. So if you ever see that in a byte, you know, okay, that's a trail byte. Then we need to move to the next one until we find the next lead byte. So it's self-synchronizing. Similarly, if you're pointing at the start of a character, you can look at that lead byte and you know exactly how many trail bytes there are corresponding to it by counting the number of leading ones. So UTF-8 has a bunch of advantages. ASCII text has the same representation as in UTF-8, which is really convenient for interchange. You don't need any byte order mark because, again, the code unit is a single byte, so there's no, you know, there's no big endian, little endian concerns. There is an optional BOM, so if you ever see the code units EF, BB, BF at the beginning of a string, that is the UTF-8 BOM. And what that actually is if you took the Unicode BOM, the FEFF, and you encoded it using those encoding rules we had before, that's what it would look like. So many byte-oriented string functions still work with these, just like with the variable width encodings. You can use strcpy to copy one of these strings because the null terminator will only show up at the end of the string. Finally, UTF-8 encoded text requires less storage than 16-bit and 32-bit encodings for most languages. There are some languages for which UTF-8 may require up to 50% more space than UCS-2. It's only a few languages, which is good, but unfortunately those languages tend to be used by an awful lot of people in Asia. However, we'll see in a little bit that is not such a big deal. So what about UCS-2? We had this thing that we came up with in Unicode 1.0, and a lot of really large systems were built on top of this. To name a few, Windows was basically built from the ground up using UCS-2. Java uses UCS-2, or used UCS-2 when it was first created. .NET, there are a lot of large systems that use this encoding. And now we've said, oh hey, you know, now we've got this nice 8-bit encoding, and we've got this nice 32-bit encoding, but you know, that 16-bit encoding that you built for, that's not a thing anymore, sorry. So obviously we can't use UCS-2 because 16 bits is not enough to encode all of the characters in Unicode now. But there's a replacement encoding, UTF-16, and that basically what it does is it reserves a set of code unit values. And it says, hey, if you see one of these code unit values, then combine this code unit with the next one. And so we can take a look at what happens when we encode text using UTF-16. So if we encounter a code point that's larger than 2 to the 16th, and what we do is we subtract 2 to the 16th from it, and we get a value that is now 20 bits, because we've eliminated all of the code points that are representable using only a single code unit. So then if we represent that in binary, we take the lower 20 bits, or we take the lower 10 bits, and we add it to this special value, DC00, to get DF78. We take the upper 10 bits, and we add them to D800, and we get D83C. And so these are called high and low surrogates, and so these are called surrogate pairs. This is a very kludgy way to represent text, and that is exactly what this is. It's a giant kludge in order to enable compatibility with these old 16-bit systems. So basically, if you have a UCS-2 system, you can add support for these new rules, and you can now support all of the new Unicode characters. So really the only advantage of UTF-16 is that there's some level of compatibility. But now we have all of the problems of old variable width encodings, which is that, you know, we've got this very complex encoding. Every character requires at least 2 bytes, so ASCII text is now, you know, still twice as large as in UTF-8. None of the byte-oriented string functions work with this. It's a variable width encoding. And the last one is interesting. So if you sort lexicographically, so if you sort like byte by byte, strings that are represented in UTF-32, then what you will get is you'll get an ordering by their code point. So, you know, if you have the Latin letter, the capital letter A will appear before the capital letter B. The same actually works for UTF-8. Even though it's a variable width encoding, it was very carefully designed so that you could just sort the bytes, or sort strings of bytes, and you would get the same ordering as in UTF-32. This does not work with UTF-16 because, again, it's just a giant kludge. So to recap on these encodings, UTF-8 is basically the universal encoding used for interchange. It's a variable width encoding, so it's a little more complex to deal with, but it turns out we've gotten really good at dealing with this. It turns out there are some really fast SIMD implementations of conversions between UTF-8 and other other character encodings. And by far, it's the most commonly used for storage and data transmission. UTF-32 is very simple, but there's so much wasted space, it's practically not used anywhere. UTF-16 would probably not exist at all if we didn't have UCS-2. So finally, I mentioned that there are some languages for which text may be up to 50% larger when represented in UTF-8 than when represented in UTF-16. This is the full set of languages. This is based on analysis of a giant corpus of text that you can find online. That's a link in the slide comments. But again, obviously, some of these languages, like Japanese and various Chinese languages, are used by a lot of people. It turns out that this size difference does not matter. And the reason that it does not matter is that, first, this is for dense text. So this is like if you have a text file and all it has in it is, you know, for example, Japanese text. That is not very common. More commonly, we have, for example, HTML, which has an awful lot of space characters. It has an awful lot of ASCII for the markup. Similarly, even if you have dense text, if you run this through any, you know, good compression algorithm, so if you go and compress such a text file in a zip file, then UTF-8 and UTF-16 compress about the same because they both encode about the same amount of information. There may be some slight differences, but in practice, again, it does not matter. And credit for this analysis goes to a colleague of mine who works on the Windows team. So that is an overview of the Unicode encodings. Like, we now have three encodings. Why is Unicode complex to deal with? So the first reason that Unicode is complex to deal with is that it supports dynamic composition. That 1.1 million characters that we said we could represent, that is not enough. So here we have the letter A. Does anybody think this is very complex? This is not very complex. But we don't always just have a letter A, right? The A can wear lots of funny hats. And so we need to be able to represent all of these different letters. And we do that through what are called combining characters. And so what we do is we have the base letter A, which is represented by code point 41. And in this case, we're combining it with a combining diarysis, which is code point 308. And that forms this text element. So it's important to note that this A with diarysis, in this case, is not a character. It's composed of 2 characters. And we will call it a text element to disambiguate between the two. It depends on what resource you're reading as to whether or not like that A with diarysis might be called a character. But in the Unicode specification, it is not. And so we will not call it that here. And we can actually compose all sorts of things. So for example, here we've combined the letter E with a lower bridge and a tilde and an X. And the order of these matters. So for example, here we can see if we have the tilde appear in the string of combining characters before the X, then the tilde binds more closely to the E. And if we have the X appear closer first, then it will bind more closely to the E. The order does not matter for some of these. So for example, the combining lower bridge binds to a different part of the letter, so it could actually appear right after the E or after the X or after the tilde, and it will appear in the same place. So this means that we can have basically strings of characters that all combine into a single text element, and the order of some of these matters, and the order of some does not. This makes many text operations rather complex. So how does all this look in C++? Well, in C++ 11, two new types were added, char16t and char32t. And these are UTF-16 and UTF-32 code unit types. And then we're just going to reuse char for the UTF-8 code unit type. This is rather unfortunate because now we can't distinguish between legacy, you know, we just have a normal C string with whatever encoding we had before, and specifically UTF-8 text. But this was rather necessary because most POSIX systems use UTF-8 with char strings, and they expect that they can work with strict copy and things like that. Note that I am not going to mention, well, I will mention it, but we're not going to talk about WCHAR-T because you cannot write portable software that uses WCHAR-T. So we also have, in C++ 11, Unicode string literals. So you may be familiar, you can have an L in front of a string literal to make it a wide string literal of type, with WCHAR-T elements. Here you can have a U8 in front of a string literal, which will make it a Unicode, a UTF-8 string literal. You can have a lowercase u, which makes it a UTF-16 string literal, and then you can have an uppercase u for a UTF-32 string literal. In all of these, you can also use universal character names. So for example, backslash u2603 is the snowman, and or if your compiler supports it, and it may not support it, you can actually just embed Unicode characters inside of the string. We also support Unicode character literals, sort of. So, obviously, if we have the letter X, which is an ASCII letter X, so it's representable using a single byte, we can represent that using a char. If we have the snowman, we can't represent that using a char. A char is only eight bits, and the snowman requires at least 16 bits to represent. Similarly, if we have a character that's outside of the basic multilingual plane, like the martini glass here, we can't represent that using 8 bits either. So both B and C up above are not, those are not well formed. The compiler should reject. A char16T can only represent characters that are in the basic multilingual plane, so characters that are representable using 16 bits. And then finally, char32T can represent any Unicode character, and it will represent it using its code point value. C++ also has an amazing Unicode string type. I'm actually just kidding. There's no Unicode string type. What we do have are basic string specializations. So you can store UTF-8 text in a std string. I mean, a std string just stores a whole bunch of bytes with a null terminator. And then there are specializations of basic string, U16 string and U32 string, that have char16t and char32t code units. So for example, you can see here that we can store all the different string types inside of all of the different kinds of Unicode strings using those. But there's a bit of a problem here. First, you have to remember that it's just a dumb sequence of code units. So we're not storing code points, characters, text elements, grapheme clusters. We're not, you know, any of these more advanced things we're not storing. Iterators iterate over code units, not code points, not characters. Size does not return the number of code points. We'll see how this works in a minute. And functions like front, back, and the subscript operator don't work like we might expect. So for example, if we have a UTF-8 string, A, which says hello, and we'd like to say hello to the snowman, so we'll try to push back a snowman character. But that doesn't work, because pushback just takes a char, and the snowman does not fit in a char. So in order to do this, we have to actually store the snowman into an array of char, and then insert him into the end. You could probably also use plus equals would work here. Similarly, if you have, you know, a U16 string and you try to push back a character that's not representable in 16 bits, then you would need to do the same thing. The only string type where you can actually work with characters is U32 string, because then again, your code point, which, you know, is up to 32 bits, is representable, you know, using 32-bit code units. So let's talk about string length, which should be really, really easy, right? If I asked you, what is the length of this string? Anybody? 5. Yes, the length of this string is 5. We can simply walk 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and count the characters. But what about Unicode? Can anybody tell me what the length of this string is? Yeah, that's a good answer. So first, we should decompose it into what this actually is. So this is four characters. We have the number one, the letter A, the combining diarises, and then this martini glass. And if we encode this in various in the three encodings, you can see that it's encoded in different ways. So you know, in UTF-8, we require, in some cases, numerous code units. In UTF-32, it's one code unit per character. So the first concept of string length, and the easiest one, is, well, how many bytes are there? And you can do that by simply counting the number of bytes. I've color-coded each byte so that you can count them yourself if you'd like. The second kind of length that we might consider are the number of code units. So in this case, UTF-8 has an 8-bit code unit, so the number, the length is the same as the number of bytes. UTF-16, we can count each 16-bit bit element, and UTF-32, we count each 32-bit element. The third that we might consider are the number of code points. This is also the number of characters, given our definition of character from before. And for each of those encodings, the length is 4, because we have, as we see, 1, 2, 3, 4 characters. And finally, the one that we are probably most interested in this context is, how many text elements are there? Well, there's 3. There's 1, 2, 3. We can count them in the string, and we can see that one of those text elements spans 2 characters. So to recap, there's at least 4 different possible meanings of string length. The number of code points and the number of text elements is the same. That should say the number of code points and the number of characters is the same, regardless of encoding. So if we want to calculate the string length, so for example, we have that string in a split string, and we call s.size, well, we're going to get whatever the number of code units is, because that's going to count the number of code units, which are bytes. And if we iterate over the elements, maybe using our new range for loop, we're also going to get code units, not characters. So this is not useful if you want to go and look for a martini glass, because you've got to go and handle all the decoding yourself. All right, well, length computation was not easy. So maybe equality will be easy? So we can first look, what is equality? Well, we can talk about representational equality as the simple kind. And so for that, we simply use operator equal equal on the string types, or we could use strcomp in the C library if we have string literals. And this will basically just look at each byte, and it will say, are these 2 bytes equal? Yes, then move on to the next one. Are these 2 bytes equal? Yes, and so on until we either reach the end of both strings or we find that they are not equal. This works for Unicode strings as well. This works for the Unicode string literals. Again, as long as your combining characters are in the same order in both strings. Sort of. We have this problem that some text elements have multiple representations. So, for example, we saw the A with diarises can be combined by using the capital letter A and the combining diarises. There's also a single code point that is Latin capital letter A with diarises. Why do we have this? Well, because one of the goals of Unicode was compatibility with existing text encoding. So they want to be able to take text in any commonly used encoding, like Latin 1, and transform that into Unicode and have it be a lossless transition so that, when you've encoded it in Unicode and you convert it back, how to get the original string back. And so that is why we end up with this. Similarly, even the letter A has multiple representations. In this case, it's representable by code point 41, which is the normal ASCII Latin capital letter A. There's also FF21, which is the full width capital letter A, and this is used in some Asian languages when printing to the console. Obviously, some Asian characters cannot fit in the narrow column that is used for English letters, and so there are these full width equivalents of the Latin letters that basically take 2 spaces on the console or in fixed width encoding so that you can nicely line up text. There's also ligatures. So, for example, the F and the I. And is also representable using the Latin small ligature fi. There are Roman numerals for some numbers. This, I'm not entirely sure what the origins were of this. I suspect that there were some encodings used for text processing or for document layout that had special characters for these. And then finally, we had the example of, well, if we have multiple combining characters and they affect different parts of the letter, then they may be in different orders on the text encoding. So Unicode has what are called equivalent sequences. And there are two kinds of equivalence. One of them is canonical equivalence. So for example, this is what we see on the first line, and this is what we saw with the A with diarices, is that, you know, if we see the single character A with diarices, or if we see the capital letter A followed by a diarices combining character, these should be treated during text processing as absolutely equivalent. Like we should not treat them differently. They should be rendered the same. They should compare equal to each other. And the other kind is compatibility equivalence. And so if we go back, for example, to the Roman numeral XII, this is a compatibility equivalence. Like perhaps, and this is useful, for example, if you're searching on a web page, like you pull up a web page and someone has used this funny Roman numeral character and you type in your search box XII, you probably want to find that. And so that is where compatibility equivalence is useful. And so in order to compare strings, you have to normalize them. There are four normalization forms, and basically you can either do canonical normalization where you only normalize based on the canonical equivalence, and then there's compatibility normalization where you normalize based on the compatibility rules as well. And then you can either normalize into composed form, so for example you would normalize an A with a combining diarices into the single character, and decompose form, which is where you would take the single character and decompose it. Normalization also includes a well-defined ordering for combining characters, so that if you have a string with a whole bunch of combining characters after a letter, it will reorder them as much as it can in such a way that you can compare strings. So how do we do normalization using the C++ standard library? This slide is also intentionally left blank. All right. Well, equality is hard, but maybe less than ordering will be easier. So, yes, obviously std::string has an operator less than, and we can use that to compare strings. We can do the exact same thing with Unicode strings, but again, these are representational less thans. They're not, actual textual comparisons. But as a good point, this is actually not just specific to Unicode. This works in ASCII too. So let's say that we have this set of strings, and we want to alphabetize them using std::sort, and then we'll print out the result. Will this print out an alphabetical list of the strings? No, because it's going to sort them by their code point, and all of the capital letters have code points that appear before all of the lowercase letters. So in order to actually sort things by language, we have to use do what is called collation. And to do that, we need a locale. So in this case, we construct an English locale. We sort using that locale. I actually learned when preparing these slides that it's possible to use a locale in this way. I thought that was kind of cool. And it will output the expected result. And the reason that we have to use a locale is that this ordering is language dependent. So here, for example, we've got a set of characters. We have, so the second A has a diarices, and then we also have the regular letter A. And if we sort this in German, the A with diarices is just an accented letter A, so it will appear right after the normal A. But if we're in the Swedish locale, the A with diarices is actually its own letter, and it is collated after the letter Z. So this is rather a problem. So how can we do Unicode collation using the standard library? I'm very sorry, there is very little in the standard library that is useful for working with Unicode text. It's funny that we added all of the Unicode string literals and made a big deal out of that, but that is literally all that there is. So that works only for narrow string sequences. And locales are entirely implementation. So the question was, can't you use, didn't I just show using a locale, and isn't that part of the standard library? But what locales your implementation supports are entirely dependent on your implementation. So for example, on Windows, we do not support UTF-8 locales. On POSIX, almost everything is UTF-8, generally. So this is, writing formal code doing this is very difficult. So we can look at a few other text operations. Maybe there's something that we can find that's easy. So let's say maybe we want to we have a lowercase character and we want to make it uppercase. So we have this nice function, std::toUpper. This is a fairly common thing to do. But this does not work in Unicode. Why? Well, most standard library manipulation functions are code unit based. So if we look at, you know, these functions, they take a char T. So if we pass in, you know, a UTF-8 code unit, well, that might not be an entire character. So these only might work with UTF-32, which again, like we said, is not common, and we're probably not going to be dealing with that. Another problem is that there are some languages where there is no single uppercase form. So for example, in German, the I believe it's the sharp S. Yes. The uppercase form is actually two characters. It's two capital letter S's. So there's no way to make that work with this sort of two upper function. There's no way to make this work with, you know, the classification functions, because these only take a single code unit or a single character for the UTF-32. So there are a few things though that do work. You can do encoding conversions using the code CVT header. Last I checked, libstd C++ does not implement this yet. I last checked in May, though, so that may have changed. And you can use this to convert between different character encodings. You do have to be careful here, though, because char16t, as we said, is a UTF-16 code unit, except in some cases in the C++ standard where it is required to be a UCS2 code point, which is not very useful. You can also do I/O using code CVT. So for example, here we write some UTF-8 data with a bomb, and then we open it back up using a basic IF stream with a char32t element type, and we use the code CVT facet to convert from UTF-8 to char32 on the fly. And when we actually read that and we iterate over the characters that we get, we'll see that, you know, we actually get the code points. That is basically all that you can do with the standard library. But there's this great library, International Components for Unicode. It's open source. You can find it online. It has a huge set of features. It probably has everything you'd ever need for processing Unicode, and then a whole lot more. It's very widely used, so it's well tested in a lot of real world software. It runs on many platforms. It has a permissive license, so those are all beneficial. I had a lot of trouble getting it to build on Windows. I had to use a pre-built thing for Visual Studio 2010, but It does build for Windows, at least. It has its own string type. It's called Unicode String, and it uses UTF-16 internally. Now, yes, we said UTF-16 is a giant hack, but this library predates UTF-32 and UTF-8, so that is why we have it uses UTF-16 internally. It doesn't work well with most other string types, so like if you want to convert or if you want to work with ICU, you actually have to, you know, use it consistently or pay conversion costs each time you want to work with it. It is not modern C++ by any definition of that term. It says on the slide it was originally written for Java. That's not entirely true. It was actually originally written in C++, but then it was ported to Java because someone was like, "Hey, this is awesome. Let's use this software for Java." And then once they did that, they changed all the APIs, made them very Java-like, and then they said, wait, we also need these in C++, so they ported them back. And so basically we have something that, I don't know, it might be a nice API in Java, I haven't looked, but, you know, as with much software written in the 90s, you know, it's not quite what we in 2014 would say is beautiful, awesome C++. So it has two character types. UCHAR32 stores UTF-32 code units, or full code points or characters, and UCHAR stores UTF-16 code units. And then finally, if you want to store UTF-8 code units, you can do so using char arrays. It has this Unicode string type. It does allow you to convert from other encodings. So for example, down here you can see we're converting from UTF-32 or from UTF-8. It has a bunch of operations that actually work on characters. So for example, you can append, you know, a full character to your string, even if it's outside of the basic multilingual plane. It does support normalization. I'm not going to go too much into detail here. We are running a bit out of time. It supports collation, but as you can see here, this create instance function returns a raw pointer, so, you know, we had to use a unique pointer. Even worse, it also supports regular expressions, and this you actually have to use new. So there's, it's not great from that point of view, but because it has an enormous amount of functionality, and because it's so well tested, it's a great library to use. So if you want something that's a bit, you know, better for C++, there's a library called Boost Locale that basically, so it's introduced in Boost 1.48, and it's a modern C++ API. It does not have any Unicode functionality within it. It basically binds to different backends, so you can have it either sit on top of ICU, or it can sit on top of POSIX or the WinAPI. It's not nearly as feature-filled as ICU, but it supports, you know, all of the common things that you might want to do. And so to work with this, basically, you have to create a new locale, and it uses this generator because locales are very expensive to create. So for example, you can create a UTF-8 locale in this way. This works even on Windows with the Visual C++ libraries, even though underneath we don't support UTF-8. Normalization is very straightforward. If you have a string, so for example here we have the two representations of the capital letter A with diaceses, we can combine into decomposed form, and we can combine into the composed form, and you know this will work as we expect. It takes a string in, it returns a string. Everything is very convenient. You can also use the locale for collation. Again, still you need to. So in Unicode actually has a well-defined collation order that is language-independent, but also has language-dependent collation orders. There's a number of comparison levels that you can use. This is important if you want to like do collation that sometimes are case-sensitive, sometimes are not, or whether you want to consider accents or not. Boost Locale has conversions for string types. So, for example, you can convert from a UTF-16 string to a UTF-32 string, and this is a very nice, neat API. Finally, if you have text that's encoded in some other encoding, so here's our Cyrillic string from before, you can encode that as well, or it can transcode that as well into Unicode, and here by passing in the name of the source encoding. And the set of encodings that are supported depend on what backend you bound to. Generally, unless you have some reason not to, probably binding to the ICU backend is the best thing to do. It also provides string-based case manipulation, so it'll have a two upper and a two lower that take a string, not a character, and that way you can actually do the correct conversions for all characters. Finally, it also has boundary analysis. So this is useful. Basically, you can get iterators into a string, and you can iterate over full code points, characters, or text elements. In this case, we create a character iterator. This is actually a text element iterator. It's unfortunate that it is named character. But so, for example, we can iterate over this subject string, and if we just get the size of the string, it's going to be 8 because it takes 8 bytes in UTF-8 to encode that. But if we compute the distance between this segment, between the beginning and end of the text element segments, we can see that we get 3, which is what we'd expect. Finally, Boost Regex can also bind to this library and thus to Unicode, and you can have Unicode regexes. And so, for example, here we have a regex. This is a well-defined Unicode regex that matches any number, and so it will also match, the 12 Roman numeral and the 5/8 fraction. I don't think this is particularly useful, but other sorts of Unicode regular expressions would be. So finally, look at some resources. The Unicode Explain book is from O'Reilly. It's very good, very easy to read, pretty thorough. How many people here have read the C++ standard and found it impenetrable in many places? Yes? Everybody else has not read the C++ standard then? The Unicode standard is actually really easy to read, and comparatively. And in addition, there's a set of technical reports and it's all freely available on the Unicode website. There's a number of technical reports that describe design rationale and why things are the way they are, and proposals for new features. And it's actually really easy to read. I have links here to Boost Locale. Boost Nowide is written by the same author as Boost Locale, and it's used for it's mostly ideal for Windows, so that you can avoid having to deal with wide character strings in your program while still using the underlying Unicode APIs that require wide character strings. There's this website, utf8everywhere.org, which has a lot of good arguments for why we should all be using UTF-8 everywhere. And then there's this nice question on programmers.stackexchange that on should UTF-16 be considered harmful? And there's a lot of good discussion there. There's no consensus, but there's a lot of arguments, pros and cons for different encodings. So with that, are there any questions? Is there any movement in the C++ standard committee to address these deficits? Yes, there have been several proposals. One of the big questions, though, becomes, do we somehow retrofit or like kludge our existing string types that are used almost everywhere, or do we create a whole new set of string types? And, you know, I think if we create a whole new set of string types, we'll get made fun of, because isn't that what everybody does in C++? Yes, so there have been several proposals along those lines. There's no one driving the effort. I was asked to submit a proposal after I gave this talk at C++ Now, though I have been unfortunately unable to, you know, have time to work on that yet. Maybe next month. But yes, everybody realizes that this is actually a big problem, and some people like to have, you know, more than just a hello world in their C++. Or maybe a hello world that can be read in other parts of the world. Any other questions? Yes?
Yeah, you said that you don't want to charge students. Shouldn't be used. Is it because it's 16 some platforms?
Yes, exactly. So the problem with WCareT is that it can't be used portably, right? So on Windows, it's a 16-bit code unit. In some older software, it will be UCS2, but in modern software, it's UTF-16. And on Linux, it's just infrequently used. It's a 32-bit code unit, and it's just not possible to write software using WCareT that is portable. And so that is why I would recommend against it. I know that makes it very... That is a difficult thing to recommend, certainly because on Windows it is so pervasive, and all of the new Windows APIs and all the, you know, the APIs you want to use take wide characters. I would tend to recommend that, like, if you're doing a lot of interaction with the Windows API, that yes, maybe you use WCareT in that part of your code and then transform to UTF-8 for the rest of your program. If you're only calling the Windows API infrequently, like maybe you take a string and then you call create file with it. Like, you can easily do the transformation on the fly when you do that call. And that boost no wide library that I mentioned before, they have wrappers that can help you to do that, and that is very useful. Because if you're just going to call create file with a file name that you've transformed, like the encoding transformation on the file name is, you know, it's a drop in the bucket compared to the cost of actually going and opening a file. And so, you know, it depends how you decide to handle that depends on, you know, what you're doing in your program. Yes?
You said the Unicode doesn't know anything about graphical representation.
Right.
But it does know if there is
Yes, the combining characters. Yeah, so the question was, I said that Unicode doesn't say anything about how text is represented. Like that's kind of true. Like, if you go and read the Unicode spec, and they've got these giant tables of characters, they have, you know, sort of a sample representation of what characters look like, right? Like, we know the A looks like, you know, it's got a little triangle thing with a line in the middle, and we know that the combining diarises is two dots above. And so, we know that because we're familiar with the letters, and if, you know, if you're a font designer, I'm sure that you know more about this than I do. There's probably not any font designers here in the room, though. Like, you could create a font where the code unit A mapped, or the code point A for A mapped to, like, you know, something like a squiggly line or something, but like that would not make, like, it would not be useful. So it's basically incumbent upon, you know, font designers to build useful stuff, and for people who build layout engines to build layout engines that place those combining characters in the right locations per their specification. So the one other thing that I will mention that came up when I gave this talk at C++ Now, the question came up, if I want to use Unicode text in my C++ program, like actually in my C++ files, can I do that? It was pointed out that, like, you can't even write portable C++ today, because there's no, like, yes, the standard has this, it requires that, you know, the translation character set has a particular set of characters, but it doesn't have to actually say how those are represented. So the answer to can I use Unicode in my C++ code is it depends entirely on your compiler. Most compilers should support at least some, you know, amount of Unicode, but what they do, I actually don't know the answer to that. So with that, if there's no more questions, thank you, everybody. I'm happy to answer any questions afterwards, but thank you. And thank you, Steve.